everyone. Welcome to Everyone Has a Story with Liza Page. My very special guest artist today is a man called Freddie Knoller, who has very kindly allowed Tony Johnson and myself into his home, enabling us to record some of his, I'm afraid, heartbreaking experiences during the last World War, when he was captured and interned in both Auschwitz and Belsen concentration camps.
I was born in Vienna, in Austria, on the 17th of April, 1921. As you can see, I'm a young man of 92, and long may it last. Let me tell you, actually, my story is the story of the 6 million innocent Jews who were murdered by the Nazis during the Second World War. Of these 6 million, actually, 1.5 million were children below the age of 16. This was me. In fact, I'm showing you now a picture of my family where you can see my father and mother underneath, behind the clock. They are standing there. We were three boys, actually, part of the family. My parents loved music so much that they made sure that every one of us was forced to learn an instrument from the age of six onwards. Each one of us had to learn an instrument of the age of six. There you will see my oldest brother Otto, who was 8 years older than I, playing the piano. He started to learn at the age of six. My middle brother Eric, actually, who played the violin, he had to learn the violin, and he actually was 2 years older than I. I myself, at the age of six, had to learn the cello because my parents wanted to have a trio, a musical trio. And there you will see, in the next picture, you will see the trio of the Brother Knollers, das Trio der Brüder Knoller, playing at home, and we were playing actually also on charity function there. You will see the program. In 1932, my brothers and I, we were playing for a charity function in Vienna. We were playing Joseph Haydn Trio number 1 in G. And there you will see the program. And the life in Vienna, in Austria, was really beautiful. On the family's picture, you will also see a lady who was a cousin of my mother. And she lived right next door to us. She was very much part of the family. Just to remind you, actually, what happened. Hitler became Reich Chancellor of Germany in 1933. But Austria was a different country. We were completely nothing to do with Germany. And all the time from 1933 until 1938, when Hitler invaded Austria, we were told, we heard all about the atrocities that the Germans did against the Jews, against Gypsies, against anybody who was not pure German. You know, they didn't like black people, and they didn't like anything. These atrocities we heard about, the laws which the Germans did against these people affected us to a certain extent, but we were not part of Germany. Then on the 11th of March 1938, Germany invaded Austria, and the harassment against the Jews started more or less immediately. There you will see the picture of the Jews having to clean the pavement of the street in Vienna. There you see that rabbi with a beard, that old man, having to clean the streets. And look at the faces of the population, how they smirked and laughed. They enjoyed themselves. They enjoyed themselves to make the Jews work. And also, on next picture, you will see that any any shops which was owned by Jews was very clearly marked. Very clearly marked. In fact, you will see here, there you will see how they put on a big black letters there, Jude, J-U-D, and then there's an E coming at the end. Quite soon afterwards, they also had an exhibition, anti-Semitic exhibition in Vienna, and there you will see the poster of this exhibition, which was called the Ewige Jude, in November 1938, was playing in Vienna at the railway station in Vienna. And all the time, naturally, the Germans didn't want the Jews, the population to go into these Jewish shops, and they put big signs up there, "Do not buy from Jews." And this was the situation in Vienna during this period. Somehow or other, the situation was bad, but it was still possible for us to live. But then in November 1938, a new law came on, whereas any Jew who was not of German nationality was taken by force from their home and was taken to the border where they came from. Because so many Jews came from Hungary and from Poland into Germany and Austria to better themselves. And some people, really, there was one family by the name of Greenspan, actually, who lived for 35 years in Hanover in Germany. There was husband, wife, and daughter. They were taken by force from their home. They were only allowed to have 10 Reichsmark in their pocket and only one suitcase with clothes, and they were taken to the border of Poland where they came from. When they arrived in Poland, this family phoned up their son, who was studying medicine in Paris, actually. And that boy, who was 25 years old, was so upset what happened to his parents, you can well imagine. And he went to a gunsmith, he got himself a gun, and with that gun he went to the German embassy, and he killed a German diplomat by the name of von Rath. I show you the picture how he was arrested, and also how the picture of von Rath also. When this happened, there was an uproar in the whole of Germany and Austria. How come a Jew can go and kill a German diplomat? Immediately, the Nazis went to all the synagogues, burned down the synagogues. November 1938, they burned down all the synagogues. The people, when they saw Jews in the streets, they went to the Jews. My father stopped us from going out. In fact, we were not allowed to go back to our schools. We were not allowed to mix with Christian children, with Gentile children. And we were not continue as in 1938, I was in the high school, in the gymnasium. My oldest brother Otto, who was a medical student at the Vienna University, he wasn't allowed to continue to go to university. And so everything happened in November 1938, which was the most terrible period in our during that time. Immediately we heard that people were arrested and, as Jews, they were recognized as Jews and were deported into concentration camps. In November, one evening, we suddenly heard people coming into the... Our apartment was on the third floor, a big apartment building. Our apartment was on the third floor, and suddenly at night time, we heard people coming into the courtyard of that apartment building. And we saw Nazis in uniform coming into the building. And naturally, we were worried, are they going to come to us? But these people went on the first floor, there was a very well-known Jewish family by the name of Epstein, actually, there. And Mr. Epstein jumped out of the window to escape. into the courtyard, and he was lying there in the courtyard, and we saw that the Nazis took the whole family out from the building, plus the body down there of Mr. Epstein, and disappeared. Well, when this situation happened, my parents were very, very worried and upset what has happened to us Jews in that period. Well, there my father called us all together and he said, look here, you boys, you cannot possibly live in a country where these things are happening. This is not for you. You have to somehow disappear. And our cousin, who was part of our family, got hold of an American contact that she had. It was a cousin of her in Florida. And quite soon, in December actually, a visa came for one of the Knoller boys. That was my middle brother, Eric, who was playing the violin, actually. He was the first one to leave from Vienna to go to Florida. That's where the people lived in Florida. And I remember the name of the people who sent him the visa and the papers. My oldest brother, Otto, who was a medical student, he went with another medical student to the Dutch border, and he went illegally into Holland at night time, went to Rotterdam, and he was able to get himself a boat to take him to England. I was the youngest, 17 years old at that time, 17. But you know, it was a different ball game of 17 nowadays, because we were so controlled by our parents, very much controlled. And then we were quite naive and immature to a certain extent. And whenever somehow we rebelled a little bit, well, we got claps, you know, we got smacks from our parents, but it didn't affect our love for our parents. But this was the strictness of the education of the children. And you know, I remember I rebelled a little bit because I wanted to educate myself at 17. I read some naughty books at night time on the toilet. And in these naughty books, I read about Paris, and I read about the Moulin Rouge with the half-naked dancers on the stage. So anyhow, but this was a different story. And when, as I was the last one actually not to disappear from Vienna, my father said to me, look, we have some friends in Belgium, in Antwerp. And he took the telephone, phoned up the friends, and naturally asked him, could I send Freddie over to Vienna? And they said, naturally, come, send over, we'll take care of him, don't worry about it. So in 1938, end of the year, or 1939, I went from my parents, took me to the Belgian border. My father hired a guide to take me illegally at night time into Holland, into Belgium, and I went to Antwerp. I was very well received by the friends of my parents. I never met them before, but there were so many refugees coming into Belgium, running away from the Nazis, that the Belgian government created the refugee camps for the refugees. And I was put into a refugee camp, and there I was together with young people my own age. And it was a lovely camp, we were very well fed. We had an orchestra in that camp. And my father sent me my cello from Vienna. I was playing in the orchestra. Life in that camp, refugee camp, was really wonderful. Everything was wonderful. But life didn't last so beautifully, because in 1940, the Germans invaded Belgium and Holland, these two parts. Some people from our refugee camp went up to Ostend to find a boat to take them to England, but I, having read about France, I spoke a bit of French, so I want to go to France. I and two other boys together, we went to the Dutch border here. I made a map of my desperate journey, actually. And there you see, I went to the border, French border, and there the French gendarme ask for papers. And I show you now the only papers that I have. It was a German passport, actually, Deutsches Reich, German passport. This is a passport of my brother Otto, because I lost my passport, naturally. And but I had the same passport, a similar passport. The Germans put a big red J on the front page of the passport to show that the person who, the owner of that passport is a Jew. With this passport, I went to the French gendarme and I said to them in French, moi je suis juif, je veux rentrer en France parce que je ne veux pas rester avec Monsieur Hitler. I'm a Jew, I want to go into France, I don't want to stay with Mr. Hitler in Germany. The French arrested me as an enemy alien. They didn't care whether I was a Jew, but they saw the German passport with a swastika there. They arrested me and the two boys who were with me also. And they took us from Lille, actually, all the way down near the Spanish border. And I have the map here to show you to a place called Saint-Cyprien. Saint-Cyprien was near the Spanish border. There, we were put together in a concentration camp of the enemies of France. There were real Nazis there, and there were many German and Austrian Jews there, and we were together. And if you remember, it didn't take very long when the French government capitulated to the Germans. The Germans invaded the northern part of France with Paris as its capital, and the southern part of France with Vichy as its capital. And the man in charge of Vichy government was Marshal Pétain. Marshal Pétain was a great collaborator, and whatever the German wanted him to do, he did. In fact, the first thing the German said immediately, will you please release the real Germans from Saint-Cyprien, but the Jews have to remain in that camp. And that's what happened. We Jews had to remain at the camp. I must tell you, this camp, it was really not a very good camp, because we had very little food, no washing facilities, and it was really quite soon cholera broke out and typhus broke out. And my two friends who came with me into that camp also contracted cholera. I saw some people dying there of cholera. I said to myself, I can't stay here. I have to disappear from here. I went at night time. I went to the barbed wire. We were guarded by Senegalese soldiers. Went to the barbed wire, and there, at the barbed wire, I dug myself underneath the barbed wire, and I escaped from Saint-Cyprien and made my way to a town called Gaillac. Anyhow, Gaillac was a beautiful farming community, and it was harvest time, actually, and the farmers needed people to help the harvest in. We all worked for the farmers. They paid us very well. We worked very hard. But all the time, by the way, why did I go to Gaillac? I forgot to tell you that. Gaillac, because my first cousins, the sister of my wife's brother, actually, was living in Gaillac. And we worked together at harvest time, and but all the time I wasn't happy. I said, I'm here in France, but I want to see the Champs-Élysées, I want to see the Eiffel Tower, I want to see the naughty district of Paris, which I read in these naughty books about Montmartre. I want to go to Place Pigalle and the Moulin Rouge with the half-naked dancers. So my cousin said, you are bonkers, you're completely mad. How come, I mean, you are here in unoccupied zone, you want to go to Paris, you're mad. I said, yeah, but this is what I want to do. Well, make a long story short, when I saved up 100 francs, I got myself some false identification papers. I became a Frenchman from Alsace-Lorraine. Why Alsace? Because Alsace is a former German province, which was part of France. And the people from Alsace all had a German accent when they spoke French. So I changed my name to Robert Metzner, born in Metz. And with this false paper, I made my way from Gaillac to Paris. Crazy when I think about it, how stupid I was to go from the unoccupied zone and go there where the Nazis are.
You were young.
I was young and adventurous. I liked adventure, and this was me. I arrived at the Gare du Nord in Paris, full of German soldiers at the station, Army, Navy, Air Force. And then I went to the metro and I saw the big map of Paris there, and I looked at the map and I saw Montmartre, oh, Place Pigalle. Yes, this is where I want to go. And that is actually where I did go. I took the underground, went to Place Pigalle, metro Place Pigalle. I went out of the metro, and there again loads of German soldiers at Montmartre. And I saw a Mediterranean-looking fellow talking to a group of German soldiers there. And I listened to what he was saying. He said, "You come with me and I will show you gorgeous girls. You will have lots of fun with them. Come with me and you will come." And he took that group of German soldiers down Rue Pigalle into a nightclub called Paradis. And in the nightclub, when he took them there, and then when he came back, I tackled him. And I said to him, "You know, I also speak German because I'm from Alsace-Lorraine. My name is Robert Metzner. And between you and me, I'm a bit broke." Make a long story short, this boy, who was a Greek fellow from Greece, by the name of Christos, Christos and I, we became very good friends. He introduced me to the owners of the cabaret, of the nightclubs, of the brothels, and wherever we took German soldiers into these naughty places, we really received a commission, a percentage of what the people spent in these places. It was very well organized. I must tell you something, between you and me, we really earned a lot of money there. We did very, very well.
Fantastic.
But it was quite a... But, you know, somehow, in 1942, I suddenly saw some Jews with a yellow star coming, because a new law came on in 1942 where the Jews had to wear a yellow star when they went in the street. They were not allowed to go without the yellow star to show that they are Jews. And I really felt a little bit like a traitor. There I'm earning money from my enemies, but these Jews go and have to display that they are Jews. One day, I was standing at Place Pigalle again, and I saw two civilians coming towards me. Long black leather coat with a hat on, and they come to me and they ask me in French, "Qu'est-ce que vous faites ici de parler avec les soldats allemands? What are you doing here to talk to German soldiers?" So I answered them in German, "Oh, but I'm a guide. I'm a guide to show these soldiers who maybe come from the Russian front, they don't know Paris. I showed them the beautiful sights of Paris." Immediately they took me into their car, took me to Gestapo headquarters. These were two people from the Gestapo, the German secret police, and started interrogating me. Said, "How come you speak such a perfect German? I mean, it's not like a Frenchman, like a German you speak." I showed them my papers. "Here you will see that I was born in Metz. In fact, at home in my parents, my mother can't even speak French, but my father speaks a little bit of French, but most of the time we only speak German at home when we are with my parents, because we are formerly from Germany." I said, "Look here, you speak perfect French and perfect German, and we need people like you. The job that you're doing there with a cabaret there in Place Pigalle, this is not for you. We want you, we need people like you, because most of us don't speak French and we need interpreters. And if you come and work for us, you would be earning a lot of money. And you will be working with your own people." I said, "Oh yes." And while he was talking, actually, I saw on his desk a plaster head of a human being in plaster, And he saw me looking at it. Oh, this plaster head, this is a head of a Jew, because we were taught how to recognize Jews by the structure of the head. With that, he got up from his desk. He went behind me and he took my head between his two hands, tracing it. I'm not ashamed to say I wet my pants because I was so sure now he will recognize that I'm a Jew. And he traced it and traced it. Oh yes, I can see you come from good German background. The guy who was taught how to recognize Jews now tells me I come from good German background. Said, I want you to come next Monday I want you to meet our officers. I want to introduce you to our officers, and I want you to come and work for us. We need people like you. I said, sure, thank you very much. I never thought I'm going to leave Gestapo headquarters, but this is actually what happened. I left Gestapo headquarters. I went back to my friend Christos on Place Pigalle, and I said, look, Christos, I cannot work here anymore, because if I don't do what they tell me, you know, they may deport me to a concentration camp. He said, look here, I must tell you, leave it with me. Give me about a day or 2 days, leave it with me. And really, 2 days later, Christos introduced me to a Monsieur Albert, who was a leader of the French resistance. And Monsieur Albert interviewed me, and we've decided I'm going to come and join the French resistance. And he took me from Paris. Yeah, but it was 1943, it was already, the whole of France was occupied by the Germans. Even the unoccupied zone was still occupied, was already occupied by Nazis. And there was the group Bessière, was called, our resistance group, up in the hills, hiding up there in the hills, away from the main course, up in the mountains, hiding. And there we were taught how to shoot, we were taught how to put explosives together, and we were taught how to make sabotage in town against the Nazis. And I must tell you, I was so elated to finally fight my enemies instead of earning money from them. It was wonderful for me, especially one day we derailed a German troop train near Figeac. It was so fantastic. I was so happy to be in the resistance, and wonderful. 1943, what do you expect? I was 22 years old. 1943. 22, I met a girl. Jacqueline was her name. Jacqueline, we started a relationship, and you know, it was okay in the beginning, but somehow or other, that Jacqueline, although she was very pretty, but somehow or other, she was quite a moody girl. And sometimes we had arguments, and one day when I couldn't stand it anymore, I said, Jacqueline, enough's enough, you go your way, I go my own way. She didn't like that. She went and smacked my face and ran away. I went immediately back to my resistance group, and after 2 days I said to myself, well, maybe I shouldn't have really done what I did to Jacqueline. Maybe I shouldn't have. And we always met in a bistro in Figeac, the same place, the same bistro all the time. And so after 2 days I went back to the bistro hoping to see her again. But she wasn't there, but instead two French gendarmes were waiting for me and arrested me, took me to their office and started interrogating me. They wanted to know all about where my resistance group is, what we were doing, the names of the people there, the location where we are, and naturally I wouldn't talk. And I recognized immediately Jacqueline must have told them that I'm in the resistance, because she knew about it. And they went and smacked my face, blood all over me, and to make me talk. But never ever would I ever give away my friends in the resistance. And they even took lit up cigarettes, put the cigarettes on my, they burned my body to make me talk, but no, I certainly wouldn't talk. But when I couldn't stand it anymore, I said, stop, stop it. I will tell you the truth. The truth is, I have nothing to do with any resistance group, but the truth is, I'm not Robert Metzner from Alsace, but my name is Freddie Knoller. I'm a Jew from Vienna, hiding up there in the hills, in the mountains, from the Nazis, because I'm a Jew. They were flabbergasted, because very rarely did a Jew admit of being a Jew, because it would have been the end. In fact, for me, it was the end. Because really, somehow or other, the French put in touch with the Gestapo in Figeac, and that was the town where we lived. And in Figeac, the Gestapo put me in jail and found that really what I was saying was the truth, that I was Freddie Knoller in Vienna. And I knew, told, I had to tell them the address, etc. Anyhow, this immediately, the Gestapo, then afterwards when they found I was a Jew, they taken me from Figeac, taken me to Paris, and outside Paris is a concentration camp called Drancy. Drancy was a camp where 25,000 Jews were incarcerated awaiting deportation to the east. And every transport was exactly 1,000 people, every transport. My name came up on the 6th of October, 1943. 6th of October, 1943, my name came up. And me and 1,000 people, men, women, children, all together, we were squeezed in into cattle wagons. And I'll show you the photo of the cattle wagons, how we were squeezed in. It was impossible. We had 10 wagons, cattle wagons like that, 1,000 people, 100 people in each wagon, and the Germans counted it. Men, women, children, old people, young people, all squeezed together. It was impossible to be comfortable in this with 100 people in the cattle wagon. So, in the train journey, actually, from Drancy to somewhere in the east, I became friends with a doctor, French doctor, Dr. Robert Weiss was his name. And he and I, we became very, and he was a very good organizer, and he shouted, come on, let's organize ourselves, because it's not possible, we do not know how long we are going to be on the train journey. And he allocated for the old people and the women and the children a seat, they can lean against the wall, their own seat. And then he said, we young people, half of us will stand, and half of us will sit on the floor, and every 4 hours will change. Those who are sitting will stand, and those who are standing will sit. And this is somehow where we survived a most terrible journey, a journey which I will never, never forget. It was the most horrible journey. The atmosphere was terrible. They gave us a bucket, an aluminium bucket, which they called a sanitary bucket, where people had to empty themselves in that bucket. And you know, men, women and children in public, there was no curtain around. The people had to do it in public. It was so demeaning, really. And it's quite soon, urine and excrement was overflowing. The stench in that wagon, I will never forget. Suddenly, and we didn't receive any food or drink whatsoever during the whole of the journey, which was 3 days and three nights without any food or drink whatsoever. It was something I will never forget, but this terrible journey. Suddenly a woman shouted, my baby doesn't breathe. My friend Dr. Robert Weiss went actually to that baby, and the baby really was dead. Quite soon the old man collapsed. He was dead. By the time we arrived at our destination, after 3 days and three nights without anything to eat or drink, four people were dead in our wagon. Well, the doors opened up. I saw SS in uniform there, and the loudspeaker came on. You are here in Auschwitz concentration camp, and we want the young men to come in front of the wagon, line up in front. The young men, you will walk to the camp. It will take approximately 10 or 15 minutes for you to walk to the camp. And everybody else, don't worry, the old people and women, we will all take care of you later on. Well, we lined up, Dr. Robert Weiss next to me, and we walked to the camp, to Auschwitz. And as we arrived at the entrance of Auschwitz, there was a big sign there at the entrance with Arbeit macht frei, work gives you freedom, there at the entrance. We heard music playing, and we had to march in unison, and we saw people in striped uniform, in pyjamas, in the orchestra, playing there, the march music, and we had to march in rhythm. And there we were taken to a block, and we were told to undress, and they gave us each one a uniform, a striped pyjamas. This is more or less what happened. Quite soon we were taken to another block where old prisoners came, and they took the old prisoners with shears, and they cut all our hair off from our head. And people who came with their wives and with their mother, maybe, they asked the old people, tell me what happened to our family. We only see men here. We don't see any women here. I said, you should never ask that question, but I will tell you what happened. As you were taken, you had to walk to the camp, they were taken, the other people, the women and the old people, direct to Birkenau, and in Birkenau they have gas chambers and crematoriums, and they were killed in Birkenau. We didn't believe that, because Germany was not was a cultured country. I mean, we didn't believe how could they do that. I mean, how? But they said to us, quite soon you will smell the sweet smell of the burning of their bodies. And this is actually what happened. Soon we heard it. We felt and we found that what they were saying was really true.
An unmistakable smell.
Pardon?
An unmistakable smell.
Yeah. Anyhow, so then we were taken to another block. The Germans were there, registering our name. They wanted to, the name of our parents, our brothers, sisters, and everybody, you know, all written down, registration. And each one of us was given a number, and people, the people came with their tattoo and put that number on our arm, and they said, you will never be called by your name anymore, but you will call by your number, and whenever your number is called, you will have to answer. So we realized we are not anymore human beings, but we are a number anymore, only. This was the situation right now. Soon we were taken finally to another block where they allocated a bunk where to sleep, and for the first time after 3 days and three nights, we got a bowl of hot soup. Finally, the first time they fed us a bowl of hot soup there. And two people had to sleep in the bunk. The next morning, actually, we were told to go and line up in front of the block where we slept. And they told us, you're going to work for a German chemical factory, which is a little way, not too far from our camp. And two soldiers with guns accompanied us to walk to the German chemical factory, which was called the IG Farben Industry, IG Farben Industry. And there, in the German chemical factory, we were told a job to do. The first job that I had to do was they put bags, 25 kilo cement bags on my shoulder. And this 25 kilos is very heavy. And we had to take these 25 kilo cement bags into a building and then emptying it. But we were not allowed just to walk with it, but we are forced us to run with these 25 kilos. And I saw some older people like me, they couldn't do it. They collapsed. Right away, the Nazis took these people who collapsed, took them away. We never saw them again. And somehow or other, I was strong and I was able to do it. And I made sure that I am not being hit, because if you don't walk fast enough, they smacked you. And this was my story. And I must tell you something. I knew that we could not possibly survive for very long. We could not possibly survive for very, very long, because the little food that we got in Auschwitz. Let me tell you what food we got. In the morning when we got up, we got a black coffee and we got a slice of bread with a margarine on it. After that, we went to work. At 12:30 we stopped work. And we received, for half an hour we stopped work, and we received a bowl of hot soup, very liquid, hardly any vegetables in it. In the evening at 6:30, 7 o'clock, depends on the season, we went back to our block where we slept, and we received another bowl of soup. And I must tell you something, it was impossible actually to work so hard and to live with that little food that we got. The hunger, I will never forget the hunger that we had, the thought that we had only for food. We needed more food because you couldn't possibly live for very long. And one day I saw my friend Dr. Robert Weiss in the camp. He said, "Oh, hello, how are you? What are you doing?" He said, "Well, you see me here, but in 2 weeks' time I'll be dead." And I told him what I was doing, that heavy work with the running with the 25 kilo cement bags. And he said, "I tell you, because I'm a doctor, they put me in charge of the Krankenbau, which is the hospital in Auschwitz. I want you to come to the hospital every night when you come home from work. I will try to find extra food for you." Every night I went there. Sometimes he found me a piece of bread, an extra piece of bread. Sometimes he found me another bowl of soup. Once, I will never forget, once he found me a piece of salami. Wow! A piece of salami is unheard of. I'm so sure that I'm alive today because my friend Dr. Robert Weiss was giving me this extra food.
Fantastic man.
He was fantastic. And you know, he had contact with the administration. He got me out of the cement commando. And he put me in an easier commando, sweeping the floor with brooms in a factory there. That was so easy to sweep the floor. And you know, to be indoors, it's so unbelievable important, because in winter in Poland, it's minus 25 to 30 degrees temperature, minus 25, 30 degrees temperature. And if you're outside when you're thin, pajamas, you know, you didn't live for very long. But indoors, to work indoors, it was a blessing.
Yes.
It was fantastic. And thanks to Dr. Robert Weiss, I'm alive today. Anyhow, I went and got a better, easier job. And you know, 1944 already, we heard Normandy landing, the Allied troops are coming into Normandy. And the rumors of this, we didn't know about it, but we heard rumors, Normandy landing. We heard rumors whereas the Russians are pushing back the Germans from Stalingrad towards Poland. We heard rumors whereas the British army is pushing back the Germans from Tobruk in North Africa. And all these rumors that we heard were so amazing, so important. It gave us a lease of life. We hoped, and I knew we will survive. We will have to survive. You know, it is terrific. December 1944, we heard artillery coming from the east, and the the Russians are pushing back the Germans towards Poland. And in January 1945, the whole of Auschwitz was evacuated. We all had to walk from Auschwitz to another town, which was about 30 kilometers away. In January, the temperature was -25 to 30 degrees temperature in January. And we had to walk on ice and snow 30 kilometers to a place called Gleiwitz, from Auschwitz to Gleiwitz. And there, this was the famous death march, because so many people died on that road. People who were older, they couldn't walk anymore. They sat down to relax, but immediately the Germans who surrounded us with guns shot them, those people who couldn't walk anymore. And some people tried to escape into the woods adjoining to the road where we were walking. They were shot. And that was a terrible journey. So many people died on the journey. And only half of us actually arrived in Gleiwitz. I was fortunate. I was one of them. I arrived there. They put us in an abandoned brick factory in Gleiwitz there, and we were allowed to sleep on the ground. No blanket or no cushion, no mattress, just on the ground we slept, but we were so exhausted from that. It was so fantastic that we finally slept. We didn't know what happened to us. In the morning, that guttural German voice, raus, aufstehen, raus, you have to get up. And we got up, I got up, but the guy next to me didn't move, so I pushed him, come on, you gotta get up. And he didn't move. When I saw, actually, I turned him over, I saw he was dead. And he was not, he didn't have the Jewish star on his uniform, but he had a red triangle with an F on it. And when I saw this, I knew immediately this was a political prisoner, probably a communist. The F is from France. And when I saw this uniform with the triangle, I saw he was dead, I tore off his triangle from his uniform and put it in my pocket. In the next camp, I exchanged my Jewish star against this triangle, became a political prisoner, because to be a political prisoner is so much better than being a Jew, because Jews always had the worst jobs and the most dangerous jobs to do. We were taken to the next camp from there, which was Dora-Nordhausen. Dora-Nordhausen, I show you the picture. There we were sitting around the table putting machineries together, because Dora-Nordhausen, they produced the V-1 and V-2 rockets there. It was in Germany, a camp, a factory. That's where we had to put machinery together. They told us what to do. One day we were sitting around the table, and we were in charge, a political prisoner from Poland actually was in charge of us, and we knew it was towards the end of the war already. We knew it was the end of the war, there was very little discipline. So that political prisoner said to us, come on, why don't we make some sabotage? Let's put some sand into these machineries, because, you know, maybe the rockets are not going to explode. That's what we did. But the Germans found sand in the machineries. And in retaliation for this terrible thing, when they found the sand, they took at random 50 Jews, lined them up against the wall, and took a rope, each one around the neck, and with slow machineries, they lifted them up with their neck, their rope around the neck, and they were strangled. They were not hung. And we were forced to watch them how for 20 minutes, 15 to 20 minutes, they died. How they could do that. And immediately, this is how they were forced us to, and I will never forget this terrible view, how they hung them, put their hands together on their back, and they couldn't do anything, but they were strangled. Well, I must tell you, it didn't take very long. The Americans were approaching Dora-Nordhausen. We were finally taken to our last camp, which was Bergen-Belsen, Bergen-Belsen was the worst camp ever. And we
worse
knew.
Worse than Auschwitz?
Huh?
Was it worse than Auschwitz?
It was worse than Auschwitz because we didn't receive, as we arrived, no food was given to us ever. It was the end of the war. They let us go queue up to get some water. There was one tap of water in the camp. And we were not allowed, we could not eat anything. I know I dug into the ground to find roots to eat, somehow or other. And I saw with my own eyes the people, actually, the older people, you know, just collapsed. And some people of hunger, they died on the ground. The ground of Bergen-Belsen was full of dead people who died of hunger. Because there was no food was given to us. And I saw with my own eyes some young people finding sharp stones on the ground. And they went with the sharp stones to their bodies, dead bodies, and cut up the flesh from the body and roasted it over fire.
Cannibalism
was ripe in Bergen-Belsen. It was something terrible. And that was... We arrived in Bergen-Belsen in March 1945, and on the 15th of April, six weeks after we arrived, the British Army entered Bergen-Belsen, liberated us, and right away they saw so many dead people on the ground, they took the German guards and forced them to dig mass graves around, and they had to take their bodies and put them in the mass graves. And we all wanted to go against these Nazis guards, against them, but the British Army said, you mustn't touch them, they are prisoners of war, and they wouldn't allow us to get them and kill them. We wanted to kill them.
What a shame.
What a shame. Well, and anyhow, when that happened, the British Army fed us beautifully. And I remember the first food that we got from the British Army. I will never forget. They had hot milk and rice. They mixed the rice in the hot milk. And they told us, look, you haven't eaten for so many weeks now anything. Don't stuff it in yourself because you'll die. The stomach will not be able to take it. Take it easy, slowly. And I took it very slowly, ate slowly, and so many people couldn't resist it, they stuffed it themselves, and so many people died after liberation. It was terrible, but I became stronger because of the food that they gave us. And somewhere 2 weeks later, actually, the British officer shouted out, he's saying, look here, we are getting low on food to feed you. And somehow we want 10 volunteers to come with us by truck to the nearest farms, and we're going to steal from the farms whatever food we find from the German farms. And I became a volunteer. I went with them, I went with 10 people and the two soldiers with guns to the nearest farms, and we found in the barn sacks of flowers and bread and whatever we found. We just put it on the truck. And I remember I was standing in the kitchen, actually, and I saw in the kitchen something sticking out behind the cabinet. And I took it out. There was a big portrait of Adolf Hitler there, hiding behind the cabinet there. I took it out, the picture of Adolf Hitler, and the farmer was standing outside with the soldiers, British soldiers, arguing with them. And I went with that picture, and I took a kitchen knife in my left hand, and I went to that farmer outside and said, see, you farmer, that's what we do with your Adolf, that's what I do with your Adolf Hitler here. And I took the kitchen knife and I slashed that photo in front of him. And he came to me and he spat at me. I didn't know what my reaction would be immediately. I had a kitchen knife in my left hand, I stuck the kitchen knife into his belly. I just didn't realize what immediately the British Army, the soldiers were very upset with me. You shouldn't have done that. You're going to have a lot of problems.
Well, that's easy for them to say, isn't
sure.
it? They hadn't suffered the way you had.
Exactly. But this was my That was me. It was a reaction I couldn't control. Mm. I stuck that knife, but it was only a kitchen knife. So I didn't kill him. Well, this is how it was. Anyhow, this is the situation. Immediately the British soldier says, look, we better take you to the camp immediately back. The officer of the camp was very upset with me. It's very naughty what you did. You shouldn't have done that. Said, you better disappear. As far as I'm concerned, you are free to go wherever you want. Said, naturally, I want to go to Vienna. My parents are there. He said, well, Vienna is occupied by the Russian troops, and no Jews are in Vienna anymore. They were all deported. Where else do you want to go? He said, well, I have my cousins in France. He said, yes, we'll take you to France. They took me to Hamburg, took me on a plane to Hamburg. They took me to Paris. They took me in Paris to Montparnasse. Montparnasse, a beautiful luxury hotel in Montparnasse. I had my own double bed there, my own double bed, all by myself, adjoining to the room, there was a bathroom, my own bathroom. And I remember I was lingering in that hot water. I hadn't had a bath taken for so many years. It was something, a luxury I could not. Immediately, also, the French government gave us civilian clothes to wear. But I kept my uniform always with me. Then I remembered my brother Eric, actually, who was the first one to go to Florida. Yeah, and I remember the name of the people who sent me the visa, the papers. They said, well, we want you to go. So I went to the American embassy and they said, will you find my brother Eric, who went from Vienna to Florida in 1938. I gave him all the details of the people who sent me to Florida. He said, look, we will find your brother, but you must always tell us a new address wherever you're going, so that when we find your brother, you will be able to go, to tell him where you are. I said, yeah, thank you very much. I went back to the hotel, and we all were looked at by doctors, and I only had bones on me, no flesh whatsoever. I was so thin, and the doctor said, look, we better take care of you, because we want you to survive. And he took me to a place outside Paris, to another doctor who took care of me, and he fed me, and he mentally, I was so wonderful, but the Dr. Bentin was his name. Dr. Bentin was so wonderful to me. He really made me survive. It was wonderful. And one day, actually, he said, do me a favor, put on your uniform, because I want to take a picture of you as a souvenir. And he took a picture of me. And I show you the picture. I have the picture, actually, of me in uniform, where he made me give me a shovel to show me how to say. And this picture I still have, and I'm very proud to show this picture around. Me in uniform, no hair on my head, but already I had 3 weeks of food in me, because it was approximately 3 weeks after liberation. So this is the picture, actually, I'm showing you. One day I saw an American Jeep coming to the village where we are, in the town where I lived. And would you believe, out of that village, my brother Eric, in American uniform, he joined the army, and he was part of the Normandy landing. He was in France, and the embassy found where he was, and he told him where I was. And we had a reunion with my brother Eric, who was 2 years older than I. And he said, and we cried on each other's shoulder. It was so wonderful. So he told me also that my other brother, Otto, who the oldest brother, who went to England via Holland, remember, he also went before the war started, went also to America. I said, look, you have two brothers in America, so you will also have to go to America. I said, I would love to be with my brothers, with your family. And really, in 1947, 2 years after liberation, more or less, My brother sent me papers to go to America in 1947. I didn't know any English whatsoever. So I went to evening classes in New York and I learned English. And when I learned a bit of English and I knew enough words how to talk, I got a job in a textile wholesale place in Baltimore, Maryland, which was a town between New York and Washington. And it was a wonderful life I had there in Baltimore. I earned very well and I got put together with friends of mine in an apartment. It was wonderful. I met my other brother Otto also and his family. Otto, the oldest brother, became a doctor. Mm-hmm. And my middle brother Eric, he had a family with two children already. And it was lovely actually to be together in that lovely place in America.
I can imagine, yeah. It must have been marvelous for you.
It was wonderful. Well, when I, what do you expect? One of these refugees who were there in Baltimore came to me and said, look, there's a girl from England. She's here for a few weeks. Would you like to meet her? I said, sure, you know I like women. You know I like girls. Give me the phone number. I phoned up that girl and over an hour I was talking to that girl and she had a pure English accent from London. And we made a blind date. The next day, we met in October 1950, and we were both in love with each other. We got engaged in November 1950, and in October, and we got married on the 31st of December 1950. Took us 2.5-3 months to get married. It was a love affair, unbelievable. And I'm still married today.
Fantastic.
62 years. But yeah. I want to tell you something. Naturally, after 2 years, my wife became homesick for her parents. And the parents said, what you're doing there with your, with that poor refugee, come over to England. And as she wanted to go back to England, I went with her in 1952. Her father was a raincoat manufacturer. He opened up a raincoat shop for us in Burnt Oak. And then we had teenage fashion in there. We make a long story short, we had 3 fashion shops actually.
Beautiful.
And you know, this is now, I want to show you because in England, if you are married for 60 years, you know that the Queen gives you a congratulation card.
Yes, yes.
Yes. So I got a congratulation card from the Queen. This is the congratulation card from the Queen. Where she says, I'm so pleased to know that you are celebrating your diamond wedding anniversary on the 31st of December 2010. I send my congratulations to you on such a special occasion and would like to add my good wishes for a very happy Christmas. And signed, Elizabeth R., and it's written for Mr. and Mrs. Fred Knoller.
Beautiful.
Cheeky as I am, you know, I wrote a letter to her.
Uh-huh.
I wrote a letter, you know, and I sent in that letter. Here's the letter. Addressed to Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth, Buckingham Palace, London, SW1. Your Majesty, I would like to thank you for sending us this beautiful congratulation card for our diamond wedding anniversary. For me, an ex-Auschwitz concentration camp survivor, your message and wishes are especially heartfelt because having been persecuted in the past, I now love the country I live in and I'm proud to have been the recipient of your wonderful wishes. I hope you do not mind, I'm sending you a copy of my book, Living with the Enemy, which tells the story my life story, the tragic period during the Second World War. My wife is joining me in wishing you and your family a most wonderful new year, full of happiness and especially in good health. Yours sincerely, Freddie Knoller. Would you believe I got a letter back? It wasn't she, but it's a lady in waiting,
yes,
by the name of Mary Dakita or something. And she says, I write to thank you for your letter and a present, a copy of your book which you have sent to the Queen. I am to thank you for your thoughts for Her Majesty and for your kind message for the royal family. The Queen was happy. The Queen was deeply touched by the sentiments you have expressed in your letter and sends her very good wishes to you and your wife for a happy and a peaceful new year. Yours sincerely, Mary Dorica, Lady in Waiting.
Very nice.
I must tell you, I'm so proud.
Yes.
And I show this to the children in schools, mm-hmm, because I want them all to know how wonderful it is to live in a democracy where I know atrocities like this could never happen in a democracy.
Are you sure?
I'm so sure. In a democracy, it can never happen. The atrocities that you hear nowadays, mm-hmm, happens all under dictatorship.
Yes.
And Hitler was a dictator. In North Africa, in Somalia, there are dictators. One in a country where there are Shiites fighting Sunnis, there are dictatorships. This is not a democracy. I know that living in the democracy, I want everybody, all the children who come to this country, I want them to know how happy we should be to live in a democracy.
Let's hope it stays this way.
This is my story.
Thank you, Mr. Knoller, very much indeed for sharing your incredible story with us. We're privileged. Thank you.